dan make two session in apa in to teaching in one session. Macam ni kena clash lah. Tak lah clash sangat tapi cuma alright. Jadi penat katanya petang. Alright. So how many of you ni? 1, 2, 3 8 ya ni. 8 kan? Ke 7 ni?
One more.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 8 ya? 8 only ya? This group? Your group ni? Azim?
9, 9 Okay dah. 9. Dah
so 2 cukup. Lagi lah kan? Siapa? Eh dah, dah. Dah ada 8 orang. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Seorang lagi siapa yang tak datang?
Seorang lagi. Okay.
Siapa? Okay,
dah masuk.
Oh dah. Alright. Okay lah. Ini je lah. Case presentation je lah kan? Okay. Let's start with Umul Kitab. Al-Fatihah. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah. Rahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. Okay, so this is case presentation kan? You have how many case? 1 or 2?
2.
2 cases, oh, banyaknya. Siapa? Who first?
Amin, Doktor.
Siapa?
Maya Syazana.
Maya Syazana ya yang first. Yeah. Yang second nak person lagi siapa?
Fazal.
Another one. Sorry?
Fazal Zinira.
Siapa?
Fazal Zinira.
Mana? Oh, sini. Oh, dia tak ini pun. Dia tak unmute pun, dia masih mute, masih tidur dia. Tak keluar video dia. Nanti kalau cukup masa ya, siapa yang Fazan yang second, nanti kalau adequate time we proceed lah. Tapi kalau first case ni pun dah 3 jam pernah. Alright. You got apa yang simulated case aja yang from previous case write up ya?
Yes.
Okay, what system is it? Multiple ke satu je problem dia?
Multiple.
Oh, multiple. Okay lah. So, you present lah. Nanti we discuss.
Okay. Alright. I made a slide. So, should I share it?
Okay. So, are you able to share, present? Boleh? Kalau tak boleh, nanti you minta ke Farah ni. Farah mana Farah? Boleh tak?
Sekejap eh.
Dah, siapa? Maya?
Sekejap.
Oh, belum. Boleh tu. Alright.
Okay, you see my slide? Yeah.
Okay, we can see.
So... I can't hear my slide now.
Okay, just present aja kalau tapi ini boleh aja ini nampak.
My laptop betul hang.
Hang ke?
Yeah.
Oh, usually apa? You are in? Oh, you are not in Mahal lah kan? You are at home.
Yes.
Kan? Usually apa di wifi lah di apa namanya bandwidth dia kecilnya. Kalau you urusan jalan tak payah no need to apa to show to show to
okay.
Us. You just read lah. Actually pun ideal apa case presentation ni you tak payah baca lah. You
okay.
Kena faham your case.
Alright. So should I start now? My case is Muhammad Syahril Haikal, 5 years old, male, with no known medical illness, presented with fever and right neck swelling for 4 days duration and also rash for 2 days duration. Could you hear me? And then first his fever is patients develop fever for 4 days duration, concurrent with the neck swelling and also neck swelling. So it claimed to be intermittent in fever, but then there is no documented peak temperature and also time for this fever. So the documented temperature is only 38.5 degrees Celsius, which is taken at home. So this fever is not associated with chills and rigors. Also, this fever is not relieved with syrup paracetamol and amoxicillin given by Klinik Kesihatan Kem Batu 10. And then patient also complained of neck swelling, which is at right side of the neck for 4 days durations. And then initially it is a ping pong ball size, but then gradually decrease in size. It claims, the mother claims that the swelling is hard on touch and also tender. So there is also presence of skin changes at day 3 of illness, which is the swelling become erythematous. Also, patient developed rash on 2 days prior to admission, which is the rash is flat, itchy, and then it initially start with bilateral hands and then progress to bilateral lower limb, anterior neck region, and also at the anterior abdomen. So otherwise, there is no sore throat, there is no runny nose, no shortness of breath, no abdominal joint or muscle pain, no changes in behavior, no vomiting, no diarrhea, no change in color of urine. Also, patient denied of history of contact with sick people, and also recent travel history, and also the house is not in a dengue prone area. So on first day of illness, patients brought to Kiki Camp Batu 10 and then been given syrup, paracetamol and amoxicillin, but then the fever still are not subside. And then on the third day of illness, he is brought to emergency department of HTAA when he developed rash at bilateral pump, but then discharged with syrup, paracetamol and syrup amoxicillin and also clavulanic acid. And then on fourth day of illness, he is brought to ENT and admitted into the ward. Okay. So upon systemic review, all systems are remarkable. And then for past medical and surgical history, this is actually the second hospitalization, which is the first hospitalization is at 2 years old at Hospital University Science Malaysia, due to right femur fracture post LH fall, but then there is no documented management towards this femur fracture. And then for medication history, he took syrup, paracetamol and amoxicillin given by the hospital. Otherwise, he denied any taking any other drugs beside that. And then there is also denied known drug or food allergy. And then for birth history, for antenatal history, there is no problem arise during the period. However, during antepartum, he is delivered at 38 weeks via cesarean section with birth weight of 2.92 kilograms. Due to meconium aspiration. For postnatal history, there is no complication arise, and the mom denied neonatal jaundice. So for nutritional history, however, he only was given breastfeeding for an hour, but and then continue. The reason why for only an hour is not documented in the report. And then he was continued with bottle feeding up to 2 years, and then weaning is start at 6 months with soft food and porridge. And then currently now he's having breakfast is about 2 pieces of roti canai or 1 bowl of rice with meat. Or for lunch and dinner, he's having 1 bowl rice plus fish. And then there is snacking in between. And then the patient disliked vegetables and claimed to be quite picky eater, and then denied food that he disliked. For developmental history, he's developed up to his age, which development, he could balance on one foot, and then for fine motor, he could color neatly and then draw man with head, legs, arms and features, and then could also cut a strip of paper. And then for speech, he can tell name and tell spine. And then for social behavior, he could follow instructions, and then could mix well with the friends. at kindergarten. For immunization history, he completed all the immunization according to his age, according to the National Immunization Schedule of Malaysia. And then for family history, his father is 34 years old, self-employed and a smoker, while his mother is 33 years old. She is an army officer and she was diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis and currently on medications. Otherwise, there is no family history of autoimmune disease or chronic illnesses runs in the family. So for social history, the patient is currently live with his parents in quarters Kian Batu 10. So the household income is around 1,000 ringgit. And then with the house is also have a good water and electrical supplies. And then he's a student at kindergarten and has no problem in study. So for physical examinations, on general, patient is lying comfortably on bed. He was conscious and alert.
Can we discuss history first?
Okay.
So basically yang pediatric history unremarkable kan, only yang the part of SOPI kan yang penting tadi.
Yes.
So the patient apa came for fever for how long tadi? Sorry?
4 days.
4 days of fever, okay, summarize lah. 4 days of fever related associated with apa namanya?
Right neck swelling. Right neck
swelling. And
rash.
Rash. Yeah. Mm. Okay. Rash to on the hands kan and feet ya. Yeah.
Hands and then progress to the lower limb, neck region and also abdomen.
Okay, yang tu rash only, tak ada swelling on the hands and feet.
No documented okay. In the report.
Rash.
In physical examination,
bolehlah. So
no, there's no lower limb edema.
You briefly apa present the findings tu apa aja?
Examination. For positive findings in physical examination, there is bilateral non-purulent eye conjunctivitis as well, and then there is a red cracked lower lip, and the throat is mildly injected. Hmm. And then there is erythematous tender, warm right posterior cervical lymph adenopathy, which size about 1.5 times 2 centimeter, unilateral.
Okay.
Also, there is one more is there is a macular rash at the anterior abdomen and also bilateral thigh region.
Okay. So that's apa will make up the data is very clear lah. Okay, but yang macam tadi kan ada conjunctivitis, you put lah history sikit.
But
that history, yeah, maybe you just mention macam ni ada tips tu. Need to apa to present kan? The patient has apa fever with rash, and then you should ask for conjunctivitis kan? Did you present tadi buat the conjunctivitis? No kan, buat the history.
No.
So you present lah apa? The mother or father didn't notice any apa eye redness, but you mentioned juga, but there is apa conjunctivitis on physical examination. So macam tu sebut. Hmm. Yeah. So the tips. So the make it will make the data tu well constructed. Kalau macam tadi kan history hanya rash dengan demam, hanya with redneck swelling. Apa so it is so many differential lah. Okay, so kalau you make the presentation to more detail and then bring more data, so we will get the diagnosis very easy ya. Yeah. From the physical examination tadi dah boleh tahu lah the diagnosis. Ifa, unmute. Apa your differential, nak bagi apa? Kawan tadi tahu ni tak? Siapa Maya?
Yes.
You told your friend about the apa the case ke tak?
I only told to read about this disease.
Oh, so tahu lah kan Maya. Ifa apa diagnosis?
Diagnosis.
Yeah, professional diagnosis apa? You pikir apa case ni?
My professional diagnosis is Kawasaki disease.
Yes kan, it's very clear masa apa Maya tadi dah present semua sampai PE, tapi kan masa history tadi tak no, tak fulfill kriteria kan, tak cukup. So actually kriteria of diagnosis of Kawasaki is purely clinical kan, no laboratory investigation. So that's why yang cream kriteria tu fever with cream, conjunctivitis, rash, edema, lymphadenopathy and mucosal changes tu. All these five apa namanya kriteria itu tanyalah satu-satu kan. So tadi kan saya sebut memanglah mother ni tak komplain, tapi you just mention or maybe in your systemic review, for example systemic review on eye, the mother didn't notice any conjunctivitis but there was conjunctivitis on PE, for example macam itu. Supaya make the data tu clear. Nah, apalagi rash tadi dah ada, edema tadi yang saya tanya kan, saya tadi tanya pasal edema of hand and feet kan tak ada ya.
No.
And then lymphadenopathy is there, mucosal changes ada ya. So how many positive? Mananya 4 atau 5. So it is clear cut lah. From 5 cream criteria itu ada 5 kan. Positif 4, this clear cut apa Kawasaki disease nya. Let's say kalau tak cukup kan, tercebut incomplete Kawasaki kan, but we need to think about other differential diagnosis kan. Hami apa, Hami Riza, you pikir apa lagi possible differential?
Dengue,
dia demam berapa hari tadi Maya, tadi lupa pula.
4
days, ha. So still apa possible dengue ya. Dengue itu demam juga. But usually characteristic of the dengue apa? Itu demam dia.
Apa?
Sama tak demam apa Kawasaki disease yang this patient ini characteristic of the fever apa?
Maya. A complaint of intermittent fever.
Intermittent okay. Apa? What do you mean by intermittent?
There is
on and off maknanya intermittent tu. Ada period of efebral juga. Efebral ni due to medication, dia makan obat antipyretic or memang dia naik turun sendiri. Tak tulis kat situ.
No.
So you kena tahu ya. There are many variable, many types of fever actually ya. Tapi kalau you nak apa paham cepat, at least you kena paham in acute illnesses macam ni, yang acute infectious disease ni, yang you kena paham cepat is continuous high grade fever. Apa tu contoh Hami? Hami Riza.
Yes, Ata.
Contoh
continuous
apa?
High grade fever. Scarlet fever.
Okey, tak salah, tapi itulah yang sebut barusan tu. Dengue tu continuous high grade fever. You nak pick apa, nak sebut dengue tapi tak tahu apa characteristic of dengue tu. Ya boleh je apa by basic yang apa saddleback fever, tapi tu yang classic lah. Tapi masa patient come to the hospital or clinic tu usually continuous high grade fever in the first 1, 2, or 3 days tu. Kalau yang saddleback, yang apa, pevesik tu kalau dah sampai komplit, sampai whole apa namanya course of the disease, sampai seminggu baru nampak dia saddleback fever. Tapi kalau masa datang ke hospital, usually continuous high grade. Itulah kalau nak tanya dengue, ya lah, dia akan continuous high grade terus, demam dia terus. Boleh dia turun kalau only taking medication, dia makan obat, turun sekejap demam balik. Itu you still mention continuous high grade fever but temporary resolve with PCM. Kalau yang intermittent yang macam Maya sebut tadi, maknanya dia naik turun sendiri, tak bagi obat pun dia on and off. Itu yang kedua, type kedua, on and off intermittent fever without any medication. Itulah yang tadi Hami sebut, dia like nama lain dia relapsing fever. Relapsing fever contoh sakit apa? Unmute je Hami. Apa?
Contoh lain eh? Relapsing fever.
Malaria tu.
Malaria lah yang klasik malaria. Tu. Malaria tu intermittent betul. Memang di on off sendiri, relapsing sendiri. Demam tinggi, and then berkeringatnya, sweating, and then febrile. With apa namanya? Konsisten punya pattern. Itulah kita sebut intermittent. So on and off ya, tapi without medication. Kalau with medication, maybe it is continuous lah actually. So kena pastikan. But usually Kawasaki ni ya continuous juga dia. Non-resolving fever for 5 days or more kan. Kalau awal-awal baru demam sehari dua hari, jangan diagnose Kawasaki dulu. Kalau macam ni patient dah 4-5 hari, okey lah. Okay. Lagi satu yang common kan tadi yang first continuous, second intermittent, boleh variation dia, boleh kita sebut relapsing kalau malaria. And then lagi satu yang you kena tahu yang classic ya, classic pattern tu is up and down ya, kita sebut remittent. Up and down ni maknanya dia naik turun tapi never febrile. Kalau intermittent tadi dia on off, demam and then febrile. And then usually kalau intermittent ni dia on off dia maknanya difference dia more than 1 degree lah. For example demam 38 and then febrile 36. Kalau yang remittent tadi yang up and down dia juga more than 1 degree. 38. Nah, dia kan 1 degree tapi up and down lah, sama-sama demam semua ya. Itu beza up and down, on and off. Usually kalau yang klasik up and down ni kita sebut step ladder. Awal dia demam apa low grade, lama-lama jadi high grade. Apa yang step ladder ni? Tak tahu.
Lepto.
Lepto not classic boleh, tapi yang more classic tu kita sebut typhoid fever tu. Kalau demam typhoid ya yang klasik ya step ladder dia. Naik turun biasa dia malam dia tinggi, kalau pagi tengah hari dia tak demam apa demam low grade, tapi lama-lama lagi tinggi. Okay, ya. So ini yang klasik type, yang type lain banyak lah. You nak belajar semua boleh, tapi yang penting you tahu yang ni dulu, yang this classic and common in our region tropical infectious diseases. Kena tahu kalau typhoid nak tanya apa, dengue nak tanya apa, demam dia macam mana, malaria macam mana ya. Okay. Itu baru demam ni. Yang Kawasaki ni usually dia macam continuous juga, dia apa, unresolving fever, dia tak hilang-hilang. 4-5 hari masih demam, usually sometimes datang klinik and then given antibiotic dia tak hilang. Okay, ini baru demam tadi ya. Next tadi is neck swelling kan tadi. Unilateral kan, itu klasik kan. We follow pattern cream tadi ya. Conjunctivitis ya. Conjunctivitis itu maknanya dia klasik dia bilateral and non-purulent. Kan? Sama kan tadi. Yang physical examination tadi nampak merah kan. Tak ada discharge ya. So klasik. Rash dia. Makulopapular lah. So macule and papule bukan vesicular ya. So nampaklah kat terang, kat extremities. And then next is edema ya. So yang saya tanya tadi yang kat tangan kaki tu dia ada edema ketat. Edema of hands and feet. Dia bengkak memang. Bengkak and usually ya merah lah. So, akan nampak macam glove dia macam merah semua palm dia or di apa di plantar dia. kaki cuma apa free fit lah, post of fit. And then next baru limfadenopati kan. Ya, limfadenopati dia usually unilateral kan. This one also classic kan. Dia satu sisi je kan yang bengkak. Okay. And then mucosal changes lah yang nampak merah strawberry tongue. And then red lips yang ini sampai crack lips ya. Sampai pecah-pecah ya. Okay, ini klasik lah. This case ini dah memang Kawasaki. Tapi lah ada diferensial dan lain lagi. Actually kalau pikirkan yang demam 4 hari mau boleh denggi. Tapi yang actually yang closest tuh Kawasaki apa? Coba sebut Hidayatul. Nah, apa lagi diferensial? Tadi Hamish sudah sebut tadi.
Can it be measles?
Measles boleh apa dekat juga ya. Because ada conjunctivitis juga sama. And then rash juga, tapi measles dia jarang limfadenopati unless kalau dia ada sore throat juga. Oke, boleh. Yang lain lagi apa? Siapa nih? Nah, tak nampak pula. Alif, Alif, Cik Alif. Apa?
Limfoma, Doktor.
Limfoma malignancy kan, you expect demam dia akan acute ke dia persistent or prolonged fever? Tak salah memang, tapi usually lymphoma ya, kalau kita pikir asyik naik demam, naik turun demam tu lama. Ini kan baru saja sakit 4 hari. Janganlah pikirkan lymphoma dulu, boleh you put as differential tapi nanti lah. Kita pikirkan infection dulu nih. Little group of infection. Last kali siapa nih? Siti Sarah. Apa? Tak tahu.
Tak sure, Doktor.
Ini awal ni ada lagi yang tak nampak nih. Siti Arisha. Kalau kita ping nampak kan. Oi. Tidur lah. Tak keluar video dia. Oh, dia tak boleh unmute. Lymphadenitis boleh lah. Lymphadenitis tapi apa? Kan you pikir only kalau lymphadenitis ya only the lymphadenopathy. Lymphadenitis doesn't explain the rash. And then apa? Cracked lips, strawberry tongue tu, conjunctivitis ya. Tak ada lah kan. Nah, tu Hami dah bagi jawapan lagi kan tadi dia ada sebut. Scarlet fever ya. Scarlet fever tu actually very close to Kawasaki because presentation more or less the same. Dia sama kalau dia sakit demam tinggi ya conjunctivitis juga, mata dia nampak merah. And then dia karena sore throat kan, scarlet fever kan dia ada streptococcal infection kat tekak tu tonsillitis, dia lymphadenopathy juga. And then strawberry tongue juga, tongue dia boleh merah juga. Tapi different sikit kalau nak yang apa, yang klasik tu kalau Kawasaki kita sebut red strawberry, kalau apa namanya scarlet fever kita sebut white strawberry. Kenapa white strawberry? Karena dia actually quarter tongue. Apa actually apa namanya lidah dia kotor, ya? Nampak tak poor oral hygiene. Karena banyak kuman kat situ. Ada yang sebut white strawberry kalau yang scarlet fever. Ada gitu, conjunctivitis, rash pun sama, ada scarlet fever dia sama ya, maculopapular rash juga kak, badan dia nampak merah-merah. Tapi yang klasik scarlet fever is apa Hami? Rash dia.
Not sure.
Apa? Ada yang sebut tadi sama Maya, Maya, ya.
Yeah. It start from the head or cord.
Masa kita touch the skin tu apa? Palpate the skin. Ada yang kita sebut sun, bukan vesikal, dia maculopapular. Dia maculopapular juga, tapi kita sebut sandpaper like. Dia nampak kasar kalau you pegang pasir. Kasar kan? Ini kalau you pegang kulit patient scarlet fever tu nampak kasar-kasar tu. Nampak macam you pegang pasir tu. Sandpaper like. Ya. You pegang pasir ke atas kertas. So letak pasir ke atas kertas yang you pegang tu. So kita sebut sandpaper like. Ya. Okay, apalagi tadi levodopati sama lah. Kalau skull fever ada levodopati. Yang tak ada tu hanya edema tadi. So that's why apa yang saya usually yang selalu tanya kalau Kawasaki itu edema hands and feet. Kalau ada edema hands and feet itu actually ya very classic tuh Kawasaki. Kalau apa namanya, skull fever tak ada dia, edema itu. Nak discuss apa lagi diferensial yang lain? Yang any other else? Yang nak discuss apa? About diferensial? Tak ada ya? Kita bosan. So, go back balik. Actually, you kena faham kan kenapa. Balik lagi ke mana si Maya ni. Why Kawasaki ni, dia ada conjunctivitis, ada rash, edema, levodopathy, mucosal changes. Apa patofisiologi dia? You kena faham. Tak baca.
Vasculitis.
Okay. Oh, yang baca Amiriza pula, yang Maya, yang Prisian tak baca pula. Vasculitis lah. So Kawasaki disease tu dia small and medium vessels vasculitis. So it is part of apa? Ami. Reaction apa dia?
Autoimmune disease. Ya,
hypersensitivity reaction. Autoimmune. Ada berapa type? Maya balik. Takkanlah tak tahu.
Oh. Ha.
Oh, kalau you tak tahu type hypersensitivity, saya balikkan ke year 2 nanti. Ada 4 types of hypersensitivity reaction. Yang type 1 yang immediate allergic tu apa? Histamine release tu usually yang macam asma tu. Yang Kawasaki ni vasculitis ni saya lupa pula type. Rasa type 3 or 4 lah. Nanti you cari balik ya. So dia ada hypersensitivity, patient-patient ini memang ada autoimun, so ada genetic predisposition. So that's why Kawasaki disease ini banyak kat mana? Most common area, affected area itu kat mana Maya? Tak tahu juga. Kawasaki itu kat mana Kawasaki itu?
Japan.
Prof Kawasaki itu orang Japan. Memang yeah. Most common affected itu genetik orang Japan tu, memang kat situ. And then semualah is apa namanya Asian descent tu. So Japan, Indochina, so sampailah ke apa Malaysia, Indonesia ni. So, dia ada still some genetic predisposition yang kalau sakit apa, kalau ada some infection dia boleh hypersensitivity reaction keluarlah Kawasaki disease. Nah, so that's why yang apa namanya invention dia yang jumpa case actually banyak je case kat mana-mana. Lama dah case ni. Tapi lah barulah tahun berapa tak ingat mesti. Baru ni 1976 kalau tak silap. Prof Kawasaki ni yang describe oh patient kalau with this with cream tadi 4 out of 5 kita sebut Kawasaki disease. Nama dia lah. Bukan Kawasaki yang apa yang buat company apa motorcycle tu bukan
motor.
Ya nama je orang Jepun kan sama-sama nama samalah kita pun nanti nama apa Muhammad semua orang Jepun ya banyak je nama Kawasaki nama Suzuki. Prof Kawasaki ini baru je pas away last year ke this year ya. Rasa ada this year lah sih. Baru je tahun ini pria pas away. 100 something lah umur dia. 110 kalau tak silap. Tua ya. Okay, so kena you kena faham it is hypersensitivity autoimmune jadilah inflammation kan. Inflame that involve small and medium vessels. So salur darah yang kecil-kecil dengan yang medium size je, bukan yang besar. Kalau yang large size apa? Ya aorta lah kan. Yang proximal arteries tu aorta besar-besar tu taklah tak kena. Yang kecil-kecil dengan yang size sedang. So that's why one of the typical finding kalau Kawasaki dia kena coronary artery kan nanti. yang semua features ni, yang cream ni, so related to the vasculitis of the medium and small vessels ni. Kalau kak mata dia vasculitis, kak apa, kak vessel tu, kak conjunctiva kan ada kan, small apa namanya vessel. Jadilah dia nampak merah mata. So that's why dia non-purulent. Dia mata dia merah, tapi bukan sebab infection, tapi sebab only inflammation tu, vasculitis kat situ. Kak apa, conjunctival vessels. Rest pun sama, kak bawah kulit dia vasculitis. Apalagi tadi edema ya, hands on hands and feet ni nampak bengkak, vasculitis kak, tangan dengan kaki inflame kat situ. And then lymphadenopathy pun sama, vasculitis on the lymph node system, dia bengkak lah. Yang common memang on the neck to cervical. Last sekali mucosal changes kan, so that's why nampak merah bibir, lidah tu merah sangat karena vasculitis kat situ ya. And then tadi yang klasik tadi, so that's why kenapa investigation kita kena cari, kena buat echo, cari coronary artery irritation lah, or inflammation apa nama, aneurysm ya. Nah itu ya, so you kena paham. Tapi different kalau tadi macam apa namanya measles lain kan, measles ya apa, karena demam tinggi biasa dia nampak mata merah tu. Ya adalah some inflammation, tapi apa, usually more due to the fever tu kalau measles. And then yang tadi yang closest tadi scarlet fever kan, kenapa sama, sama features, tapi actually the pathophysiology lain kan. Kalau scarlet fever kan infection of the streptococcus to the throat and the skin, keluarlah dia tonsillitis sampai lymphadenopathy. Lidah pun merah ya karena sebab inflame atau demam saja. Nah, kulit itulah yang dia nampak apa, sandpaper lah tu ya, karena rash, karena inflammation reaction juga, tapi bukan hypersensitivity lain ya. Oke, okay, dah paham ya. So, you kena paham kenapa ada keluar krim karena tadi vasculitis tadi. Actually yang similar, actually vasculitis kan autoimmune. Actually boleh je, depend on the individu. Kalau dia only attack the small vessels, apa nama sakit dia? Tak sampai medium vessels. Ami, tahu tak?
SLE.
SLE more systemic lagi dia. Kalau SLE systemic, systemic lupus dia, not SSP ya. Kalau SLE itu semua sistem kena lah, hemato kena, neuro kena. Kalau yang only vasculitis but only small vessels, dia SSP lah, only purpura, and then GI tract dia kena apa, abdominal pain and apa, bleeding, and then apa, joint dia kena arthritis, and then nephron dia, kidney dia kena nephritis. 7 small vessels yang involved. Nah, lagi satu kalau yang ini yang paling unfortunate person lah, sampai dia hypersensitivity dia sampai involve all vessels including aorta dia. Apa nama sakit dia? Dia lagi teruk daripada Kawasaki biasanya. Apa? Kita sebut panarthritis. Sampai large vessel pun kena apa? Orang Jepang juga, memang yang banyak yang vulnerable kan genetik prediction kat Jepang kan. Kalau Kawasaki kan only mild saja, mild to moderate je inflame dia, sampai kena medium vessel je. Kalau yang severe kena aorta juga, panarthritis. Orang Jepang nama Takayasu. Tak tahu pasti. Tahu tak Takayasu disease? Takayasu disease pernah dia dengar tapi tak paham lah kan. Itulah, you kena paham. Kalau Takayasu sama juga, dia panarthritis. Ya, yang paling apa, tak beruntung lah orang yang kena Takayasu disease. Sometimes ya tak selamat because severe. Oke. Okay. So paham dah patofisiologinya, findings dah. Diagnosis kalian tak tahu kan ya. Kawasaki tadi differential udah discuss. Investigation sekarang. So you nak propose nak hantar apa, Maya?
First I would stand for full blood count to see is there any anemia related to this disease.
So sebut dulu yang penting dulu. Kau Washaki kan, so nak cari apa dulu? Ha. Jangan terus credit. Jangan ikut apa list pasti ABC semua lah rutin lah tu. Tapi yang paling penting cari apa?
Echocardiograph.
Echo dulu lah, cari coronary artery aneurysm. What more kalau incomplete Kawasaki. Kalau tadi tak fulfill 4 atau 5 tu, only 3 or maybe 2. Kita pikirkan ini betul Kawasaki ke bukan. Nak bagi FEIG ke tak, because FEIG ini bukan murah kan. So kena pikir kalau semua case yang demam dengan rest bagi FEIG nanti in unnecessary treatment. Case-case measle pun juga bagi IVIG pula. Tak berguna lah apa. Useless. So penting some case yang incomplete Kawasaki kita buat echo dulu. Oh betul ada coronary artery dilatation. Nah, betul Kawasaki. Barulah kita bagi IVIG. Tapi kalau yang macam your case ni tadi kan dah complete kan. Dah full blown kita sebut. Dah 4 kriteria positif. Before echo pun kita bagi je IVIG. Kita buat echo kemudian tak apa. Okay, ya, echo penting. Okay, lain tadi FVC kenapa buat FVC tadi? Maybe ada anemia apa? Yang penting apa lagi tapi from FVC yang penting findings. Senyap pula.
Alam. What bad thing?
Apa?
White
cell kenapa?
To rule out infection.
Standar lah, standar. Standar apa namanya? Answer. Yang cari MVC, yang cari leukocytosis untuk infection. Ini Kawasaki kan bukan infection. Dan inflammation, vasculitis. Apa yang?
Platelet.
Hah?
Platelet.
Platelet dia kenapa? Ifah tu jawab tu. Kenapa? Platelet dia?
Maybe high.
Bukan might, nah. Classic finding for Kawasaki ya kan, thrombocytosis. So that's why important memang FVC. Cari thrombocytosis itu dulu yang penting tuh, because kalau case lain ya tak akan platelet dia tinggi. Apalagi kalau viral infection kan, dengue ya thrombocytopenia yang kita dapatkan. Kalau Kawasaki ini ya cari thrombocytosis. Kalau anemia leukocytosis ya memang common lah. No, klasik ya, bukan finding of Kawasaki. Semua sakit infection pun semua bacterial infection leukocyte tinggi. So yang klasik yang you cari in Kawasaki ini thrombocytosis. Oke, apa lagi? Tak ada pula. You baca case write up kan? Ada kan? Kat situ report semua tu.
Yes.
You tak baca discussion dia ke?
Yes. CRP.
Kan tadi sebut inflammation kan? Common inflammation ya pasti increase ISR CRP. Okay. Apa lagi? Macam mana Maya ni present tapi tak baca betul?
Renal profile, liver function test.
Renal profile, nak cari apa?
To look any sign for dehydration.
Cuma tak penting-penting pula. Yang cari untuk diagnostik untuk Kawasaki, jadi apa? Tak apalah, memang possible je. Tapi yang Kawasaki, yang lain apa? Anyone else? Yang lain?
CG, Doktor.
Apa? ECG, ya? Yeah?
Because
sama lah untuk cardiac finding. Boleh jumpa apa, Alif?
Because one of the complication untuk Kawasaki disease might be have myocardial infection.
Myocarditis kan? Tapi myocarditis tu ECG finding apa? Susah lah, tachycardia only lah usually. Kalau untuk myocarditis, apa lagi penting kita cek cardiac enzyme. ECG memang buat juga. Dia tachycardia je tapi tak kelas, tak spesifik kan. Cardiac enzyme boleh. Kalau you nampak patient ni tachycardia, cardiac enzyme untuk cari myocarditis. apa troponin dia tinggi lah, CKMB juga dia tinggi. L apa CKMB tu, and then apa LDH. Nah, itu cardiac enzyme ya. Okay, apa lagi?
Urine, doktor.
Urine ya. Cari apa?
Pyuria, white blood cell.
Ah, boleh. One of the apa karakteristik of Kawasaki, dia sterile pyuria. Dia leukocytosis ya, apa leukocyst in the urine but no bacteria. Dia clear sterile, tapi leukocyte positif. Oke, apa lagi? Anything else? Jadi banyak lagi event yang apa clinical findings mau cari apa lagi? Contoh, ya, tadi krim kan. Lain apa finding from clinical? Mas API cari apa? Bukan criteria of diagnosis tapi penting juga nih.
On Disformation
the...
of the skin.
Sorry?
Disformation of the skin.
Ah, yang itu nanti belajar apa namanya? Course of the disease, nanti ada phase of the disease kan. Apa lepas nih ya kita discuss. Apa lagi yang oke, yang itu tak salah tapi nanti belajar phase apa? Of the disease, progression of the disease. Apa? Tahu
Kak.
Apa sama?
Hepatitis pinamegali.
Hasem ya, hepato. Ada ya? Saya pun tak klasik sangat yang itu. Ada ya memang finding Kawasaki deh hepatitis pinamegali. Tak klasik lah, not spesifik lah ini. Boleh je ada hepatitis pinamegali, tapi not spesifik for Kawasaki. Apa lagi? Kak skin yang sulit masa, you check the left deltoid, you cari apa?
Arthritis.
Left deltoid.
BCG induration.
BCG induration tu sebab vasculitis kak. Skin tu kak sana kak, kak BCG scar tu dia jadi indurated. Dia nampak merah. Cari tu klasik tu, tapi bukan criteria of diagnosis. Tapi kalau you jumpa indurated BCG scar ni, Kawasaki lah ni. Okay ya, so itulah contoh-contoh finding yang apa yang you kena cari masa you buat investigation, masa you buat physical examination ya. Apalagi investigation yang lain? Nak pick up lagi? Nak apa? Okay lah, so you boleh hantar apa-apa lagi. Tapi
kalau
tadi yang ultrasound apa?
Of hepatobiliary system.
Itulah hepatobiliary nak cari apa Kawasaki ini?
This patient have ultrasound hepatobiliary system.
Not rutin lah, actually no. If the flow macam tadi yang Hazim kata, kalau ada hepatomegali, splenomegali, maybe kita proceed lah with ultrasound. Tapi kalau liver and spleen unpalpable, ya not rutin. Tak payah buat. Saya pun tak pernah setakat ini patient jumpa Kawasaki yang sampai hepatomegali dan buat ultrasound, tak pernah. Possible tapi still not impossible because inflammation ni vasculitis boleh kat mana-mana kan. Kalau vasculitis on the liver boleh jadi hepatomegali juga. Okay, apa? Alright. Tadi ya, so kita next step belajar yang itu ya, the course of the disease kan, dia ada berapa phase, Maya?
3.
Nah, kan ada acute and then apa?
Subacute
and then convalescence kan. Yang acute tu in the first 10 days and then subacute up to 6 weeks usually, convalescent baru setelah 6 minggu. So kena ikut this course lah, period dia. Kalau macam tadi squamation, the squamation of the skin tu masa subacute lah, selepas 10 hari dia bisa akan apa nampak kulit dia terkelupas tu. Kalau masa acute dia kan masih demam 4 hari ya, tak usually tak ada lah. Dia inflame dulu apa edema dulu sudah. Saya kan masa acute dia edema hands and feet bengkak. So masa subacute dia jadilah desquamation, dia jadi terkelupas kulit itu. Sampai peeling of the skin. Sampai apa lagi yang nail tu? Nail changes dia. Kalau yang sampai bias persisten nine. Sampai putih itu yang masa convalescent. Apa nama?
Bias 9.
Bias line tu yang convalescent kan. itulah kan the squel kan, masa IQ dia bengkak dulu, inflamed vasculitis, sub IQ dia ada some other changes, masa convalescent sometimes ada persistent yang changes. Itulah yang desquamation tu usually kalau dah patient dah tak demam. Ada contoh memang few cases dia maybe patient tak datang ke hospital ke, dia demam, bagi obat demam sendiri, PCM, and then sometimes pun Kawasaki ni kan tadi persisten kan demam dia 4-5 hari tak surut, tapi ada patient yang apa tak datang hospital, tak datang klinik, minum obat demam sendiri akan hilang juga, 10 hari dia hilang apa demam akan surut juga. So after acute phase tu will be a febrile. Tapi itulah patient sometimes datang after 2 weeks come with desquamation tadi, wow, mananya Kawasaki lah ni. Kita cek lah, sometimes ada case macam tu, kita cek coronary artery dia dilated. Okay, so kena tahu phases of the disease juga. Even actually thrombocytosis pun bukan not really in acute, can be apa most likely in subacute, tapi sometimes in acute phase pun dia boleh thrombocytosis. So that's why ini bukan criteria of diagnosis. Kenapa ya? Karena in acute phase maybe platelet still normal, tapi boleh juga thrombocytosis. Subacute dia usually more thrombocytosis. Okay, so kena tahu itu phase. And then itulah konsep apa the most important part of the finding itu tadi itu actually ya, the coronary artery dilatation. That's why we need to diagnose Kawasaki early, masa in acute phase, and give IVIG in acute phase nih to prevent coronary artery dilatation. Sebab kalau udah develop dilatation yang severe, dilatation yang aneurysm, dia most likely irreversible. Kalau patient dah aneurysm, dah arteri coronary artery dia lebar sangat, more than 8 mm. Usually irreversible juga. Jadi aneurysm persistent boleh pecah, bila-bila masa boleh rupture. Rupture coronary artery ya pass away lah. We cannot, bukan cannot. Theoretically boleh je rupture, kita stop the bleeding, then kita ikat artery, boleh pasang apa implant coronary artery, tapi itu kan in theory because timing of nak tutup bleeding tu need apa more than 30 minutes maybe untuk buka di apa heart surgery maybe 1 hour within minute patient will be pass away lah kalau rupture artery. Okay, so itulah konsep the important part of Kawasaki, must diagnose early before 10 days tuh, before acute phase habis. Because kalau udah subacute phase after 10 days, no point we give IVIG. Kita bagi IVIG pun udah develop apa dilatation, maybe pun irreversible, udah kasihan pula. Tapi kalau yang mild dilatation maybe boleh hilang kan, because mild dilatation dia inflammation dia tak banyak, and then maybe after 6 weeks dia boleh resolve. So kena diagnose awal sebelum 10 hari kena bagi, tapi memang tak boleh awal juga. Kalau for example pasien demam tadi yang saya kata demam 1 hari 2 hari ada rest, bagi IVIG. Satu maybe inflammation pun tak apa still ongoing, dua maybe not Kawasaki kan, pasien measles, pasien rubella, pasien apa exanthem mascobitum, banyak differential diagnosis of viral exanthem tu. It is unnecessary if you give IVIG. Usually lah tunggu 4-5 hari still persis, then cream pun positif, we give IVIG to stop the inflammation, to prevent coronary artery dilatation. Itu yang penting konsep of Kawasaki tu kat situ ya. After acute phase, kalau macam dah subacute, itulah kita observe patient. Usually after IVIG kan kita bagi aspirin sampai 6 minggu ni, harap-harap dia inflammation dia boleh stop. Kalau ada mild dilatation dia boleh resolve. But kalau yang usually yang untreated tu, yang apa large aneurysm atau irreversible, jadi fatal ya. Ada apa Itulah kes-kes sometimes baru tahu masa apa tadi, decommission baru, patient baru datang atau dah views line baru datang, oh ni Kawasaki, tapi kita cek dah aneurysm, tak boleh buat apa lah. Ya maybe boleh je kalau nak buat apa, itulah coronary artery punya repair tapi susah lah. Dah ya, paham Kawasaki? Dah nak tanya apa lagi? Baca lagi, oh dia lagi satu vaccination, apa vaccination in Kawasaki disease? Okay, sekejap ya, saya kena reply Prof. Hamizah saya. So nak berhenti ke nak continue? Saya penat sebab dah teaching 2 session saya dah. Continue tak ni? Siapa ni? Tadi siapa? Nur Faza ya? Ya, Faza ya? Yang kata nak present second case. Panjang tak your case ni? Mal kompleks problem ke tak? Ke simple je?
Simple je.
Okay, alright, cepatlah. 15 minit siap lah. Alright, besan.
I would like to present my case. My patient Arya, 4 years, 9 months old, legal, with no known medical illness, was presented to accident and emergency department of HDAA with complaint of body swelling and reduced frequency of circulation for 2 weeks and shortness of breath, 10 minutes prior to admission. According to her biological father, she was previously well until 2 weeks prior to admission. She had sudden onset of general swelling. She noticed that there is facial puffiness upon waking up in the morning, and it involved the periorbital area and cheeks. There were also swelling of legs, abdominal distension, and labial swelling. The swelling became worsened and prominent after drinking and eating, and it will reduce after about 1 to 2 hours. The swelling were peaking in nature, non-tender, not erythematous, and not warm. She denied any history of infected blood. She also complained with reduced frequency of urination. Previously, she went to the toilet 4 times per day and 1 time before going to the bed. However, past 2 weeks, she only went to the toilet 2 times per day and 1 time or meal before going to the bed. On the next day, she was brought to the clinic and medication was given. However, the symptom will not resolve, although given with the medication. Upon waking up in the morning of the day of admission, she had shortness of breath. The parents put the ointment on the chest area and released after 10 minutes. During the episode, there were no problems in walking, no breathing acceleration, and no sleeping. No history of apnea or there were no history of fever, cough, or any signs of infection. No abdominal pain, vomiting, lethargy, confusion, full of energy. No headache, joint pain, and chest pain. No rashes, myalgia, arthralgia, mouth ulcer, or photophobia. And no yellowish discoloration of skin and eye or changes in stool. For the patient's progression, she was brought to accident and emergency department of HDAA. The temperature, blood pressure, heart rate, and the partial pressure of oxygen were recorded. Blood tests and urine tests were done, and they were proteinuria and proteinuria for blood. On the review, on the they will know loss of appetite. So father is unsure on any weight loss. On skin, they will know changes in color and no rash. On hip and neck, no neck stiffness when lying, no ear discharge, ulcers and gum bleeding, no bruises and injury. On respiratory system, they will know cough, hemoptysis, sore throat, runny nose, or night sweat.
Faham. Ambil ikat sekejap ya. Tadi lah sama macam Maya tadi, kalau ada sistem ni, kalau tak ada sangat, itu tak payah present satu-satu. Panjang sangat nanti. Saya sebut unremarkable je. Tapi masa your clerking kan, you tanya satu-satu sistem respi ada problem ke tak, sistem hemato ada problem ke tak. Tapi masa you present ni, kalau tak ada, cakap je unremarkable lah. Kalau ada other tugas yang unremarkable kan, semua you dah present masa SOPI kan.
Yang
lain clear tak ni? Pak saya pun suara kecil sangat ni. Dah saya maksimum ni my volume ni. You boleh ni tak? Apa your ini? Dekatkan cuba. Maybe jauh sangat. Cubalah try lah. Ini tak kuat sangat tapi tak apalah. Tadi summarize baliklah. Oh, banyak dan tak apa clear tapi tak dengar sangat pak, volume dia tak tinggi. Summarize balik dia apa facial puffiness berapa hari tadi?
Okay, 4 years 9 months from Malaysia, no medical illness. Complain of generalized body swelling, reduced frequency of migration for 2 weeks and one episode of dyspnea for 10 minutes duration. It was not associated with testing. No, there was evidence of spotty urine on physical examination. There were facial puffiness and mild abdominal distension.
Tapi you kena sebut yang negatif yang penting apa? Yo, diagnosis apa dulu ni? Maya. Profesional diagnosis apa?
Nephrotic syndrome.
Okay, Hami. Differential apa? Yang paling dekat, closest.
Minimal change disease.
Sama nephrotic juga tu. Yang bukan nephrotic apa? Kalau bukan nephrotic apa?
Chronic liver disease.
Apa?
Chronic liver disease.
Liver pula. Jauhnya ini still kidney ni. Hazim, apa? Bukan nephrotic apa?
Nephritic.
Nephritic kan? AGN ke? Maybe a nephritic from SLE ke? Nephritis kan? So apa beza nephrotic and nephritic? Sama-sama bengkak kan? Usually kalau nephrotic dia more generalized lah. Tapi kalau nephritis, maybe only periorbital ke apa-apa. Tapi sometimes ya sama aja bengkak. Tapi yang in nephritis, you kena jumpa apa? Dispet edema.
Hematuria.
Hematuria, lagi satu. Apa faza yang present? So you kena make sure tak ada dua ini. Kalau ada dua ini masih boleh nephrotic syndrome, but nephritis lah. Ada yang sebut nephrotic, nephritic syndrome. So the hematuria, you tanya tak? Urine dia macam mana? Clear kan? Apa proteurin je kan?
Yes, proteurin.
Yes kan, so no hematuria. So lagi satu PE you kena sebut. BP normal kan? Ya, yeah. Normal ke hypertension? Ke hypotension?
Normal
BP kan. So that's why dia most likely nephrotic kan this case. Tapi ni memang first episode ya, bukan relapse ya.
No, this is
first episode. Okay lah. So patient like this kan dia generalized edema of proteurine kan memang pure from kidney problem kan. Tapi okay lah masa first time you nampak patient edema, you must rule out other possible causes of edema kan, other systemic causes. For example, liver problem, macam tadi chronic liver disease. And then apa lagi? Kan kidney, liver, apa lagi yang you kena pikir?
Kalau edema. Congestive heart failure.
Lagi satu, apa lagi?
Congestive heart failure.
Iya, lain-lain. Dah, heart dah. Lagi apa? Other system.
Autoimmune disease such as SLE.
Tapi usually yang more classic tu angioedema ya. Kalau ada allergic reaction dia angioedema. And then lagi satu usually nutritional problem. Dia kwashiorkor. Tahu kwashiorkor tak? Dia severe malnutrition protein. Yang protein deficiency dia bengkak ya. Okay. So memanglah masa in early presentation. Oh, you tahu patient bengkak, you kena rule out semua ini. Tapi by your complete history NPE, actually you must focus on one system. Unless memang ada some few yang non-specific findings, ada yang kita still open. Ada mungkin hari itu saya patient apa, edema non-specific, we need to open to all possibility, we check all system. Kalau macam tadi kan dah clear kan, generalized proteinuria, so kidney lah nih. Unlikely liver, heart, apa nama, angioedema tak. Nah, so memang masa in history ditambahkan kan, to rule out allergic angioedema ya tak cakap je tak ada history of insect bite ke, no previous atopy ke. And then kwashiorkor pun clear kan, dia patient not malnourished, dia adequate apa nutrition, adequate diet, contoh macam tu. Dan yang heart and liver, itulah kalau heart kan dia edema jutu heart failure kan. Klasik ya, pasti kalau patient edema jutu heart failure, you must find the heart failure first. Kalau patient not in heart failure, so it is unnecessary, it is wrong lah. You put heart failure as your differential diagnosis. Tapi patientnya ada tachypnea kan tadi ya? possible lah, boleh lah possible. Tak break and short asam press. But usually heart failure ni dia klasik, dia edema dia due to the right heart congestion. So jantung kanan dia congested. So maknanya dia congested from the right ventricle, right atrium yang AVC and SVC kan. Klasik dia edema dia kat mana? AVC punya congestion.
Abdomen.
Yang abdomen dia not due to edema. Abdomen dia lew hepatomegali. Tapi yang bengkak dia kat kaki usually. Like edema kalau heart failure tu. Itu pun very rare. Nah, patient heart failure sampai heart edema saya pernah jumpa sekali je patient itu. Itu pun baby kecil-kecil. Okay, so only like edema karena congested of the IVC itu. Dia jadi hepatomegali and then like edema. Ya. Nah, kalau yang liver disease ya itulah memang di on abdomen sama lah. Tapi liver boleh hepatomegali, boleh liver cirrhosis. Tapi kalau liver cirrhosis dia shrink, portal hypertension pula. Dia akan nampak splenomegali, nampak other stigmata of chronic liver disease. Actually by adequate history NPE, you shouldn't put apa this other system to in differential diagnosis unless yang unclear. Kalau macam ini dah clear kan, nilas edema periorbita, abdomen, and then ada proteinuria urine. Yeah, we focus on the kidney je. Masa history memang you rule out lah, you sebut lah negatif-negatif tadi yang tak ada ini, so jadilah ini kidney. Kidney pun kita tahu ini nefrotik atau nefritik. So tanyalah, apa carilah ini hypertension, hematuria. So this case, no hypertension, no hematuria kan. So it is most likely nephrotic syndrome. Dah, apa lagi nak tanya? Oh ya, tadi kenapa dia sampai short of breath? Maknanya complicated kan dia? Apa complication dia? Most likely pleural insufficient, dia jadi SOB lah. Maybe pulmonary edema sometimes kalau dia quite severe. Ya. Tapi usually yang nephrotic ni tak sampai lah edema pulmonary dia. Pleural effusion je. Okay. So nantilah investigasi. Diagnosis you kena boleh sebut dua-dua kalau nak apa. Yang proper macam ni ya. Newly diagnosed nephrotic syndrome with possible pleural effusion. Karena dia napas dia laju. Differential tadi boleh je letak nephritis. Heart failure still possible karena tadi takip ni kan bolehlah letak. Maybe takut-takut kalau ni heart failure kok. Ya, kalau liver ya unlikely. Kwashiorkor unlikely. Angioedema ya unlikely. Ya. Kalau nak banyakkan ya banyakkan kat kidney problems ya. Kan nephrotic syndrome tadi sebut Amiriza non minimal change boleh je. FSCS chronic kidney disease, SLE pun nephritis juga. Ada lagi IgA nephropathy. Banyak yang kidney disease-nya actually. Lebih rare kan yang common yang nephrotic or nephritic. Okay, so investigation ya fokus lah in this case. So first kan you cannot fulfill criteria diagnostic of nephrotic syndrome. Lagi satu tadi karena this case kan ada possible pleural effusion yang you kena check juga. Okay, so kita discuss dulu apa tuh nephrotic syndrome. Faza, presenter.
The nephrotic syndrome is a chronic kidney disease that causes proteinuria.
So ada berapa kriteria dia? Clinical syndrome dia macam tadi Kawasaki kan ada 5 dia.
Ada 4. Massive proteinuria, okay. Hypoalbuminemia,
hypercholesterolemia, yes. So yang the pun apa namanya primary problem dia apa? Proteinuria dulu kan problem dia. Dia sebut proteinuria dulu betul. Tapi jangan sebut edema akhir-akhir. Yang paling dekat dengan proteinuria ya efek dari proteinuria ya edema. Barulah kita sebut hypoalbumin yang memang karena protein loss jadi hypoalbumin. And then last kali baru sebut hypercholesterolemia. Itu apa namanya liver punya compensatory mechanism to increase apa namanya, albumin production tu, jadilah dia hypercholesterol. Okay, jumpa itu kan kriteria. So you hantar apa? Kalau edema kan clinical criteria ya, you nampak dah pasien edema usually generalized kan pada orbita, abdominal distension. Kat mana lagi you cari edema tu, siapa fasa? Tadi kata jumpa kat dua tempat tu je. Kat mana?
At the genital area.
Okay, genital. Mana lagi? Okay. Eh, tadi dah kan. Pada orbital edema, facial swelling. Kat mana?
Abdomen
kata tadi dah, abdominal distension dah, tapi ada lagi kat mana lagi? Kat belakang ada apa?
Sakral.
Sakral edema. Dua yang perisannya sama je, yang perisannya tak tahu pula nak perisan apa. Lagi satu kat mana?
Pidal.
Generalize dia. Kat mana?
Pidal.
Pidal edema lah. Dia sometimes not only pidal, sampai leg, sampai sometimes mesin, sometimes up to knee, sometimes above knee. Depend on the apa, how severe is the albumin, apa, hypoalbumin. Okay. Itulah clinical edema. Yang yang proteinuria antara apa?
Urine
lipstick test. Lipstick tu tak salah, tapi lipstick tu untuk monitor lah, nanti monitor proteinuria. Masa first diagnostic, you kena tahu exact result from the lab tu hantar apa, not lipstick. Lipstick bukan hantar, lipstick you buat sendiri, patient collect the urine and then you celupkan je di lipstick tu. Yang hantar ke lab apa? Cek apa?
Urine protein creatinine test.
Okay, yang the most specific kan UPCI itu. Dia and then better you, bukan better lah. Actually kalau for clinical macam saya kena remember the cut off ya, yeah? Because sama-sama kidney problem, nephrotic and nephritic different result kan. Yeah? So cut off is a matter, is important ya. Yeah? UPCI dia kena more than berapa? Ada habis protokol, buka lah semua tu. Tak punya habis protokol, tak ada ke? Ami, unmute. Berapa?
200.
More than 200. So, 200. Kena tahu result tu. Kalau keluar balik apa, result keluar UPCI only 150 ya, normal. Ya bukan nephrotic. Kena more than 200. Okay, apa lagi? Yang simple je, you analyze lah, UFAM tu apa yang you expect from the UFAM tu?
Kas?
Kas ni nak cari nephrotic kan nephritic. Kalau you cari nephrotic, memang lagi kita cek. Pastikan no red cell kas. Ya, tak ada erythrocyte kas. Because kalau ada red cell kas, ini nephritis. Apa from UFAM ni? Simple je. Kan clinically nampak frothy urine. Apa yang you cari kat UFAM?
Protein.
Urine protein lah berapa. Itulah. Keluar kat UFAM tu. Dia ada yang semi-kuantitatif, ada yang kuantitatif. Kalau kualitatif tu yang dipstick tadi, hanya plus or minus je. Positif negatif. Kalau yang semi kuantitatif, kalau UFAM itu akan keluar plus 1, 2, 3, 4 kan. Plus 3 and 4 itu masif lah. Criteria of nephrotic is masif. Dia kena plus 3 or plus 4. Kalau only plus 1, plus 2 ya bukan nephrotic. Oke. Okay. Ada lagi yang kuantitatif, keluar berapa gram per liter. Berapa? More than berapa? Kalau nephrotic nih. More than how much?
40 miligram.
Itu per berapa?
1 day. 24 hour.
So kena hantar 24 hour urine. Akan keluar more than 40 miligram per meter square per hour. Itu pun you kena tahu tu, unit tu. Yang 40 itu 40 miligram per meter square per hour. So after collect 24 hours, keluarlah more than 2. So you kena tahu juga 24 hours per hour, keluar for more than 40 per hour, and then per meter square body surface area. So you kena paham, nefrotik ini, kes-kes-kes ini, you kena kira body surface area, karena penting ini untuk kira tadi apa, amount of protein, satu, dua, untuk treatment, nanti kan bagi kena bagi steroid, prednisolone, berapa mg per meter square, kan. So, pasien ini you kena tahu berapa, for, berapa berat badan, apa formula for body surface area. Tak pernah tahu. Tak pernah tahu. Nah, so nanti you cari ke apa? Ya ke mana-mana boleh. Googling je keluar. Body surface area dia weight in kg times height in cm over 3600. Semua tu in square root ya. Square root of weight in kg times height in cm per 3600. So, formula itu simple ya, kalau kalau pakai kalkulator boleh, tapi actually apa nowadays kan ada yang tak punya, ada yang tak punya smartphone ya, pasti ada smartphone kan. Kalau tak ada smartphone ya, tak boleh buat online teaching. So the phone is smart but we don't. So you cari kat Google apa namanya, kat Play Store dengan apa namanya Apple Store tu, you cari apa ni, cari game je. Cari YouTube, apa, bukanlah YouTube, apa nama, Facebook dengan WhatsApp. Cari ada clinical calculator tu kat situ, free download. Masukkanlah keluar calculator tu, masukkan weight and height, keluarlah formula apa, number nanti, berapa body surface area. Agak-agak berapa yang saya coba kira, berapa dia height and weight dia, siapa? Faza, anda tak bisa kat situ, ke anthropometric measurement.
So height is
100
centimeter.
100 berapa? 114 ya?
100.
100, okay.
Yes. Okay. Her weight is 14.9
kilogram. 14.9 ya? Yes. Dah keluar ya. Ada dia 0.64. Nampak tak sini? Tak nampak. Tak apa. 0.64 usually kan apa, kalau adult tu yang dah besar macam kita ni around 1.7 kan, kalau kecil-kecil-kecil yang lagi kecil yang lagi sikit body surface area. Ini 0.64, ada yang 1 meter tu usually kalau around budak-budak dah apa, dah nearly adolescent, dah umur 10-11 tahun, dia usually 1 meter square dia. Kalau udah adult 1.7. Nah, ini 0.64 ya. So maknanya itulah nanti penting untuk calculate. Contoh kalau nanti patient ini bagi steroid kan 60 mg per meter square. So dia kena dapat 60 times 0.64 ya around 38 maybe ya. 38 mg. Terus dia. Okay ya. So kena tahu apa unit for 24 hours urine protein. Kalau yang kuantitatif yang keluar langsung masa UFEM tu dia gram per liter je. Berapa cut off dia gram per liter? Kak medical ada yang ajar tak? Prof C. Rosli ajar tak kalau kak adult? More than berapa?
Belajar.
Kenapa? Belajar? Tak dengar. Tak tahu pula, masya Allah. Kalau adult tu 3 ya. Kalau children more than 1 pun dah masif lah proteinuria dia. Normal dia kena less than 1 gram per liter. Okay ya, so semua number tu ada yang more than 1 gram per liter, more than 40 mg per meter square per hour, UPCR more than 200, semi quantitative dia apa masif 3 or 4 plus. Nah, itu you kena ingat semua. At least kan remember agak-agak. Kalau lupa number kan agak-agak lah. Because itulah kalau less than that number, ya bukan nephrotic. Nephritic pun sama kan, dia akan ada proteinuria. Tapi the number of the cutoff tadi less than tadi semua tuh. Oke, okay, you cabakan proteinuria. Lagi apa? Yang you cari tadi kan hematuria. Ada tak patient ni, microscopic hematuria. Makros kan tak ada, tak ada red color urine, tapi microscopic UFM dia keluar tak? Baca, baca lah result tu, urinary rhesus dia. Ha? Tak, tak dengar. Alamak, itulah tak faham yang present ni. Tak tahu. Alamak. Ya, kita expect tak ada lah mikroskopik. So kita cari mikro apa nefrotik je lah kan. Harap-harap tak ada hematuria. So bukan nefritis ya. Cari lagi tadi ya red cell cast. Kalau ada red cell cast ya nefritis. Oke, okay, itu yang from urine. Urine lysis, 24 hours urine protein, PPCI. And then edema. And then antara apa lagi? Investigation.
Liver function.
Liver function mainly di albumin ya. Albumin dia less than berapa? Ini again sama ya. Sama-sama proteinuria, sama-sama hypoalbumin, but kalau yang nefrotik kena less than berapa? Pasal
25.
Ah, yang present tak tahu sama sekali ni. Alamak. Kena less than 25. Kalau nefritis tu AGN, dia apa hypoalbumin juga tapi maybe 31 ke 29 ke. Still more than 25. Kalau nefrotic must be more less than 25. And then lastly, the criteria of diagnosis you kena hantar apa? Serum apa?
Serum kolesterol.
Actually ya lipid profile kan yang kita hantar, tapi kan mainly yang kita pakai itu yang total kolesterol. Nah, berapa? Kalau hiperkolesterol ini senang je, semua masa dulu medical pun belajar kan. Kalau kolesterol tinggi pun kita pun kalau kita sebut hiperkolesterol kalau more than berapa?
More than 200
per desiliter, itu yang actually US punya unit, tapi kalau UK, Malaysia ini UK kan, unit yang keluar ke lab itu bukan miligram per desiliter, tapi berapa? Dia milimol ke mikromol ya, per liter. More than berapa? You convert lah. Bukan, 5.2 kalau tak silap. Yang unit dia milimol per liter itu 5.2. So kalau you check lah kalau your cholesterol 6 ke 7 hypercholesterol juga. Usually kalau pasien yang frotik dia sampai belas-belas ada 13 sampai more than 20 cholesterol level dia. Serum cholesterol dia very high. Yang albumin pun tadi lah ada yang apa less than 25 kan. Kalau less than 15 sometimes lab tu dia tak boleh detect. Dia tulis less than 15 kalau very low albumin less than 15, maybe less than 1 sometimes ya. Less than 10 ya. Gram per liter. Nah, itu kan very low albumin, apa immediate complication-nya yang kena aware apa?
Hypovolemia.
Nah, hypovolemia. Karena di albumin very low, dia jadi hypovolemia. So, jadi shock, hypotension. Hypovolemic shock ya. Yang ini yang you kena terus resus in ED masa you accept patient in kecemasan tu, terus cek pastikan BP dia tak hypotension, buka tak ada weak pulse, cold extremities. Kalau hypovolemic shock you kena buat fluid apa resuscitation, kena bagi apa? Ideally kena bagi apa? Kalau ini standard fluid resuscitation kita bagi normal saline kan atau Hartmann tuh apa 20 ml per kg itu untuk all standar hypovolemia. Tapi in specific nephrotic kan the problem is hypoalbumin. You bagi apa?
Albumin.
kena bagi immediate albumin transfusion yang kalau boleh yang high concentration. Supaya cepat dia albumin naik dan volume dia terisi. Tapi itulah, nak dapatkan albumin kan bukan senang. Kena pindah order to farmasi, maybe need ya more than 30 minutes sometimes ya. Sometimes pun tunggu 2 jam baru sampai. Nah, takkanlah kita tunggu patient shock tuh biarkan 2 jam ya. Tetapi kita bagi apa, tadi fluid resus tadi yang permasalahan bolus. Tapi let's say albumin itu apa namanya, available ya, bagi albumin terus is better. Nah, apa ya, this patient nak buat apa lagi investigation? Tadi apa diagnosis? Tak dengar lah Faizah ni. Yang mana ni? Yang buruk ni di apa, di apa namanya? Ini kan your laptop macam mana? Your laptop volume dah maksimum lah, tapi terasa speaker apa namanya receiver ni bukan karena volume kan? You belilah apa ni? Headset baru ni. Macam siapa ni? Macam Ifah ni, headset dia mahal ni. Tak. Apa? Cek apa ni patient tadi? Diagnosis apa? Nephrotic syndrome kita apa? Hello?
Hello?
Apa? Lain semua tak tahu. Jadi kan you cari pleural effusion kan? Nah, so you buat apa? X-ray, that's simple. Actually kalau spesialis apa macam emergency physician atau kami pun kalau KID ada ultrasound machine kita buat chest ultrasound je yang lagi senang. Tapi kalau tak spesialis tak ada kan usually minta je hantar je radiologi, radiographer buat X-ray satu. Tengoklah pleural effusion. Okay. Lain apa? Investigation yang lain, complication lain apa? Tadi hypotension, hypovolemia possible, pleural effusion ni kita cek. Apa lagi yang possible?
Thrombosis, so medicate for.
Okay lah, MBC tapi tak penting lagi lah MBC ni. Lagi penting tadi Kawasaki. Tadi Kawasaki memang kena cari thrombocytosis. Nephrotic ni MBC tak penting sangat. Tak bagi markah kalau you bagi jawab FBC. Nephrotic syndrome nak hantar apa FBC? Zero. Bukan salah tapi no apa? No value. No added value. Hami ni buat apa ni? Oh, tak ada apa. Mana Nur Faizal dah hilang pula? Tak ada apa ni. Alright. Apa lagi? Complication lain apa? Kan problem kan kat kidney kan? Nephrotic. So apa? Complication to the kidney apa?
Renal failure.
Ah, boleh jadi acute kidney injury kan? Kenalah hantar RP. Actually kan RP itu ada lab tuh kalau kita minta RP keluar albumin juga. Cuma, maknanya kalau actually kalau RP itu udah include albumin, actually you tak pernah, tak payah minta LFT pun tak apa. Gas LFT yang macam OT apa AST ALT bilirubin tak penting lah in this case. Kita nak cari albumin je. So RP kita cari urium kreatinin dia, kalau ada renal failure dia akan high urea high kreatinin. Kalau high urea saja but kreatinin normal or low apa? Ya, pre-renal lah, maybe dehydration saja. In this case pun boleh ya, because kalau dia hypotension, hypovolemia, dia akan pre-renal kidney injury, dia akan high urium saja. Tapi kalau with high creatinine, maknanya kidney itu yang sakit, yang failure, yang injury, yang which is more difficult. Apa lagi? Nak cari yang lain? Untuk nephrotic maybe itulah yang penting. Tapi kan sometimes we need to rule out differentials kan. Kata tadi nak cari nephritis. Boleh je kalau apa tadi hematuria kita dah hantar. kalau you are query about the AGN, you kena hantar apa? Tak tahu pula. Aduh, seminar AGN belum hebatnya. Tapi kan in medical, you tak ada ke discussion pasal apa kidney diseases ni?
Serum creatinine.
Apa? Creatinine? Creatinine tadi dah, ERP tadi. Kalau AGN nephritic apa? Antara apa lagi?
Serum complement.
Ah ya, complement. ASOT kan, kalau cari post-tetokokal ya ASOT. Ya maybe terus swab, tapi kan tengok kan kalau tak ada tonsillitis tak payah. So, lah, kalau you need to roll out other differential, maybe you need more investigation. AGN maybe, kalau nak diagnose SLE, this one female kan? Perempuan kan, kalau you suspicious maybe SLE, ya kena hantar semua ANA, DSDNA. Tapi that, this case ni, I don't think lah. Tengok case kan, case by case punya discussion. Kalau this case, ya dah clear cut lah, ini nephrotic ni cukup. Riza, berapa je tadi siapa fasa jenis lah tadi? Protein dia berapa? Urin dia? Tak tahu. Albumin berapa pun tak tahu. Alamak. Okay. Ya, apa lagi? Satu tahu Riza, ambil aja lah. Ya, kena paham complication ya. Tadi kalau immediate, pastikan no hypovolemia, and then no kidney failure. Patient ni short term pressure, pleural effusion. Sometimes ya kalau very distended, dia boleh jadi peritonitis kan. Tapi yang peritonitis ni usually ada abdominal pain. Okay. Udah apa lagi? Treatment bagi steroid ya. Tadi udah tahu bagi kena bagi prednisolon berapa, kalau albumin very low kena bagi albumin. Karena bengkak kena bagi diuretik. Nah. Dah ya, nak discuss apa lagi? Ini grup berapa nih? Grup 1 nih. Yo, Mementis kan. So,
yes.
Leader siapa? Hazim ya.
Yes,
saya. Buat satu WhatsApp group dengan saya lah. You ada WhatsApp group yang tanpa saya. Satu-satu dia kok. Buat apa you buat grup apa? Hanya untuk sembang-sembang. Kalau grup sembang-sembang yang ikut yang grup semua satu batch ke. Yang untuk discussion this group masukkan saya nanti apa, because iyalah nanti kalau masa your last apa next month tuh maybe you can enter the hospital kan, tapi takut tak cukup patient. I will try to get some patient from apa for you lah early, because at least semua kena ada at least one patient, kalau boleh two or three patients kan. So, kalau nanti apa I will try to list down patient yang you boleh call. Maybe video call ya untuk apa untuk buat interview clerking. So you can apa get the real patient and then you make a apa case write up lah. Kalau present macam ni kan you boleh dapatkan yang macam ni simulation saja, tengok yang case-case sebelum ni. Tapi kalau for your case write up kena real patient yang your own patient lah. Jangan dari sebelum ni mananya copy paste lah kan. You tak tahu passion. Dapatkan real passion, I will try to help. And then apa? You buat case write up. Submit ni satu je lah kok. Maybe macam yang block 3 hari tu juga satu je. So you submit by week 6 lah nanti. Week 6 tu you dah masuk ini kan. Dah masuk hospital kan matanya kan. Week 6 or week 7 lah kalau apa kalau sempat. You tengok lah nanti week 6 or end of week 6. And then lagi satu yang procedures, your presentation procedures, you dah ada masing-masing dah nak present apa dah tahu.
Dah.
Oh, you ini copy paste yang slide yang block 3 tak apalah. Yang penting you faham ya. You nak present apa, how to perform. Tak apa nanti you repeat balik yang tu. Okay, nanti jom masukkan saya kat your group ni. Dan kita apa discuss few things lah.
Okay, datang.
Berapa kali session dengan saya rasa tak banyak. Yang procedure lah dengan saya. And then, tak ada lah. Yang case write up ni submit. Boleh submit ke WhatsApp tu atau submit ke nanti ada sometimes Farah dia akan buat Google punya apa, drive punya folder. Tengok lah, masih lama lagi kan. But you prepare lah. So ni tak ada no one of you yang dapat yang ada case kan. Unless you ada anak saudara ke apa-apa yang ada case-case chronic disease, you boleh je ambil. Atau actually not really chronic pun tak apa. Acute kan, you are year 3 kan. You ada cousin ke apa-apa yang sakit pneumonia ke, sakit febrile fit kan. You ambil je apa data from the parents. Tak apa, admit kat mana ke, admit kat maybe Johor ke, admit kat Perak ke, tak apa. You asal you dapat interview the parents, you maybe your aunt ke, your uncle ke, tak apa. Asal itulah nanti yang case setup tu, you communicate juga, jangan semua periksa pneumonia semua. So kena different system, one system maksimum 2 orang je. Ipun one system pun apa nama diagnosis boleh kena asing-asing lah. Kalau boleh diagnosis kena asing-asing supaya nanti kita discuss tu. Boleh asing-asing juga masa you case presentation. Macam ni jangan present Kawasaki lagi, jangan present nephrotic lagi. Kalau nak present nephritic boleh. Respi pun ada pneumonia, ada asma, ada bronchitis. Macam tu ya. So case asing-asing supaya your discussion among each other tu boleh dapatkan more input. Kalau semua pneumonia ya tak belajar apa-apa nanti. Okay ya. Dah anything else?
May I ask, yes. Kalau untuk mark CP tadi macam
mana? Nak saya announce kat sini ke? Fail semua ni.
Okay.
Dan nanti apa? Boleh tanya Farah atau tanya saya PM boleh.
Okay.
Atau Farah okay. Ini saya dah bagi ke Farah tadi markah. Itulah present tak apa? Tak belajar pula. Ya apa yang tak ada yang apa namanya yang distinction kan dulu masa year 1 year 2 ni. Hamir Rizal tak distinction pula. Tak dapat. Tak ada yang distinction.
Tak ingat.
Oh tak ingat, tak dapat lah tu. Kalau dapat pasti ingat. Tapi your base nya ada kan yang distinction dapat je kan? Ada kan? Tapi yang group ni itulah. Ke ada yang failure? Ada yang fail tak ni? Semua apa nama? Your number tu matrix number sama kan semua. Masuk tahun berapa ya? 2018 ya? 17?
17.
17 semua kan? Yang 16 siapa yang 16? Tak ada. Alright. So at least you tak pernah fail lah. Nanti kalau fail pediatrics kan first experience ya. Alright. Dah ya? Alright, so we close our session with that speaking for our session. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Doctor.
Okay, thank you. Assalamualaikum.
Salam, thank you, Doctor.
Thank you, Doctor.
Yeah.